to the Mount Olive AME Zion Church, where we are advancing the kingdom of God by making disciples. Thank you for joining us. We pray that you will be encouraged by the word that is shared on today. At the end of the message, we will provide you more information on how to connect with our church. Be blessed.
The announcements.
The 2021-2022 organizational meeting will be on Saturday, September 18th at 10 a.m. via Zoom. The first quarterly conference meeting is rescheduled to Tuesday, September 21st at 7 p.m. via Zoom. Zoom credentials for both meetings will be provided via email, class leader, and church office.
News First, Fellowship and Prayer with the Pastor. Every Tuesday at 1 p.m. via conference call. Prayer every Wednesday at 11:30 a.m. Bible study every Wednesday at 12 noon and 6 p.m. via Zoom and conference call. Sunday school every Sunday at 9:30 a.m. via conference call. Class leaders meeting is every second and fourth Monday at 1 p.m. Please govern yourselves accordingly and have a blessed week.
Hello, beloved. Thank you for joining with us for worship and word. My name is Kelsey Hopson, and I'm the pastor of Mount Olive AME Zion Church here in Waterbury, Connecticut. There is a word from the Lord for us on today. We're going to be taking a look again at Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. And I want to read in your hearing verse 7. We are in part 5 of a sermon series that is dealing with faith. Faith. Hebrews chapter 11. And I read in your hearing verse 7. And now during this message, we're going to be dealing with Genesis chapter 6, verse 5 through Genesis chapter 8, verse 22. But for right now, let's go to the word. Hebrews 11, chapter 7. And I'll be reading from the New Living Translation, and it reads, "It was by faith that Noah built a large boat to save his family from the flood. He obeyed God, who warned him about things that had never happened before. By his faith, Noah condemned the rest of the world, and he received the righteousness that comes by faith." Beloved, I want to talk to you for a little bit from the tag, Faith for a Different Future. Faith for a Different Future. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. All wise and gracious, loving God. Lord, we come now recognizing that you know all things. Lord, that you know what we need. Heavenly Father, we come asking that you would give us ears to hear and eyes to see, O God. Lord God, we thank you for your word. Lord God, and so we ask that you would meet us where we are, O God. Heavenly Father, you know how we are feeling. You know the week that we have had, the month that we have had, the year that we have had, O God. The ups and the downs, the good and the bad. You know all about it, O God. Lord, and so we come now and we surrender to you, Lord, asking that you would speak to us, Lord God. Thank you, God, that your will might be done in our lives and even in the world through us. In Jesus' name, we pray and give thanks. Amen. Amen. Faith or a different future. Faith or a different future. Amen. Right where you are, give God a hand of praise. Give God a hand of praise in advance for what God is about to do as an act of faith. Amen. Amen. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. The text said it was by faith that Noah built a large boat to save his family from the flood. He obeyed God, who warned him about things that had never happened before. By his faith, Noah condemned the rest of the world, and he received the righteousness that comes by faith. And some of you may be familiar with this character, with this individual, with this example, in the person of Noah. We know about Noah's ark. You may have heard about Noah's ark and heard about the flood. I tell you, in this area, and actually in this nation, we have been experiencing some hurricanes, and we have been experiencing some floods. In fact, floods are among the most terrifying forces on earth, and they have led to countless disasters throughout history. In Kentucky, where I live, I remember we used to have floods every now and then because we live behind beside a creek, and that creek would oftentimes overflow, and we would have to wear water boots. But anytime we heard that there was going to be a big rain, we knew that we needed to prepare for that flood. And so back to what I'm trying to point out to us in this particular situation. And floods, they have shaped the history of our nation, wiping out some communities forever and forcing others to even start a new life in another part of the country. And so there are three categories of floods: flash floods, river flooding, and coastal flooding. And one of the most disastrous, costly storms in U.S. history, and it still affects people today, was Hurricane Katrina. Hurricane Katrina. It affected southern Louisiana. And according to Sarah Gibbons, in an article published January 16, 2019, Hurricane Katrina, it made landfall off the coast of Louisiana on August the 29th, 2005. And some of you remember this. It hit land as a Category 3 storm with winds reaching speeds as high as 120 miles per hour. And so because of the ensuing destruction and a loss of life, the storm is often considered as one of the worst in U.S. history. And the amount of loss or loss of life is estimated in this particular article as 1,200 people died as a direct result of the storm. But according to National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, Hurricane Katrina is the costliest hurricane on record, inflicting some $125 billion in total damage. And other records estimate that fatalities were 1,833 people. Have mercy. And so as we take a look at Genesis shares that God created human beings, and he made them in his own image to be like himself, in the likeness of God. And then Genesis chapter 5, the Bible indicates in verse 3 that Adam, that he became the father of a son who was just like him in his very image. And so things have taken a change because we were created in the image of God. And now Adam's son Seth is in Adam's image. And things began to go downhill. And scripture says that there was a man named Lamech, and Lamech, he lived 777 years. He had a son, and his name was Noah. And Noah, at 500 years old, he became the father of Shem and Ham and Japheth. And now Genesis 6 begins to talk about a world that has gone wrong. A world that has gone wrong, the corruption of humankind. And the text, it says in Genesis chapter 6, that people, they began to multiply on the earth. And the Lord checked things out and observed that the extent of human wickedness on the earth, that it was very pervasive. In fact, he saw that everything that they thought or imagined was consistently and totally evil. And so the Lord was sorry that he ever made humankind and put him on earth, and it broke God's heart. It broke God's heart. And the Lord said, I'm going to wipe this human race out that I have created. I'm going to wipe them off the face of the earth. All the people, the large animals, the small animals that scurry along the ground, even the birds of the sky, I'm sorry that I ever made them. And verse 8 says, but Noah found favor with the Lord. Noah found favor with the Lord. And so the account of Noah and his family, Noah, the scripture tells us, Noah, he was a righteous man. He was the only blameless person living on the earth. Can you imagine that? At the time, Noah, he's the only blameless person living at the earth. It doesn't mean that Noah was perfect. But Noah, he gave a perfect effort. Scripture says that he walked in close fellowship with God. Close fellowship with God. And if we're going to be people of faith, one of the things that determine that we're people of faith, faith is what pleases God, is that we walk in close fellowship with God. And the same was said about Enoch. And so now, verse 11, God saw that the earth had become corrupt and was filled with violence. And God observed all this corruption in the world, for everyone on the earth was corrupt. And so God, he told Noah, he said, I've decided to destroy all living creatures, for they have filled the earth with violence. And verse 14, and then God tells Noah, get this, he says, build a large boat. I am about to cover the earth with a flood that's going to destroy every living thing that believe. Verse 18 says, but I will confirm my covenant with you. So enter into the boat, you, your wife, and your sons and their wives. Verse 22. And so Noah, he did everything exactly as God commanded him. And God tells him, when everything is ready, the Lord told Noah, says, I want you to go into the boat with your family. For among all the people of the earth, he says, I can see that you alone are righteous. Verse 5, Genesis chapter 7. So Noah again did everything the Lord commanded him. Noah is a man of faith. Noah is a person of faith. And so then in the same chapter, Genesis chapter 7, Noah, he's 600 years old when the flood covered the earth. And he went on board the boat to escape the flood. He and his wife and his sons and their wives. And with them were all the various kinds of animals. And when Noah was 600 years old, we see that all of the underground waters erupted from the earth. The rain fell in mighty torrents from the sky. The rain, it continued to fall for 40 days and 40 nights. I know you know the story. You know the story. The flood waters, they grew deeper and they covered the ground and they lifted the boat high above the earth. The boat, it begins to float. And then eventually, as the waters rose higher and higher, it floats safely on the surface. And the waters even covered the highest mountain, rising more than 22 feet above the highest peak. And all living things on the earth had died. All was destroyed. And the only people who survived were Noah and those with him in the boat. And the flood waters covered the earth for 150 days. And then Genesis chapter 8, but God remembered Noah. The water stopped flowing from the earth underground. And the rains from the sky, they all stopped and they gradually receded. And eventually Noah waited and Noah waited and Noah waited. And then God told Noah that he was able to leave the boat. And then chapter 8, verse 20, Noah built an altar to the Lord, and there he sacrificed to God. And the Lord was pleased with his sacrifice. And so God, here's what we see. Here's what we see. God has concluded that the world has gone against God's intentions. And God, he deals with this, and God is serious in dealing with this. And the reason why they face consequences is because the Bible lets us know that there is wickedness, evil, they are corrupt, and the earth is filled with violence. And there's no special or specific content that is given relative to any of these terms. But if you look a little bit before in Genesis, in the previous chapter, and we check out the stories of the man and woman relationship, and we look at Cain and Lamech and the sons of God, they suggest what is wrong is that creation just refused to be God's creation. Creation has refused to honor God as God. And so God has resolved to destroy everything. God says, I'm going to blot out. I'm going to destroy. I'm going to bring a flood. The end is coming. And it sees that God's creation now has begun to think of a future that is apart from the future that God desires. So it's interesting because God is a holy God. God is all-powerful God. And God really isn't angry, but God is grieved. I like the way one theologian put it, you know, that God is not enraged, but God is actually saddened. And scripture bears this out. And so God doesn't necessarily stand against God's creation, but God stands with God's creation. The evil heart of humankind, it troubles the heart of God. The evil heart of humankind in verse 5, it troubles the heart of God in verse 6. And so this is a heart-to-heart between God and humankind. And I want to have a heart-to-heart. I want us to have a heart-to-heart right now. And so we don't know much about Noah, but God knows about Noah. Noah doesn't fit in with this indictment. In fact, watch this. Noah, he's the bearer of an alternative possibility. Noah is righteous and blameless, and Noah walks with God while everybody else is doing the fool and doing the donkey and living in wickedness and doing evil. Noah is righteous and blameless. Noah is imperfect, but Noah loved God and is obedient to God. He walks closely with God, and Noah, he embodies new possibilities. And beloved, there are new possibilities that you and I have. God is a God of new possibilities, a God of opportunity, a God of second chances. And so as we look at Noah, we consider that even in this troubled world that they were in, and this predicament that they're in, that there is this alternative that God provides in the person of Noah. Something new is at work in God's creation. And I'll tell you, amidst all of this that may be going on, this pandemic and the different struggles that people are having, and in the midst of this racial pandemic, listen here, in the midst of health disparities and so much hate that is going on, there is something new at work in God's creation. And Noah is the new being. And I tell you, God wants to do something new in you. God wants to do something new through you. But guess what? It's going to take faith. It's going to take faith, because faith, it pleases God. God does something special when we exercise, when we operate in faith. And this is what Noah did. What did Noah do? He did all that God commanded him to do. We see this in verse 6. In chapter 6, verse 22 of Genesis. And then again, Noah did all the Lord commanded him. In Genesis chapter 7, verse 5. And then Genesis chapter 7, verse 9. As God had commanded Noah, God did. Noah is a model of faith in that Noah sought to be obedient to God. Noah sought to have an ear to God. But not only that, Noah had an obedient heart. And so Hebrews uses Noah as an example of faith for us. It was by faith that Noah built a large boat to save his family. From the flood, he obeyed God, who warned him about things that had never happened before. By his faith, Noah condemned the rest of the world, and he received the righteousness that comes by faith. I want to read the New Revised Standard Version, and then I want to share a few points with you. By faith, Noah warned by God about events as yet unseen, respected the warning, and built an ark to save his household. By this, he condemned the world and became an heir to the righteousness that is in accordance to faith. And so here's a point that I want to make for us. It's important if we're going to have a different future, if things are going to be different, if we want things to be better. Listen, we must operate in faith. We must operate in faith, in divine faith. This isn't positive thinking or psychology. This is divine. God gives faith. But if we're going to operate in faith, if we're going to have faith for a different future, because things had gone extremely wrong and badly. Humankind had gotten worse, worse, worse. Sin waxed worse. Wickedness waxed worse. And God destroyed everything with the exception of Noah and his family. And so here's what faith does. If we want a different future, we must operate in faith. And what faith does, one, it prepares for things yet unseen. Faith prepares for things yet unseen. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and evidence of things not seen. And so you don't have the substance of what you hope for. You don't have the evidence of the things that are the evidence of things not seen, but you have faith. And because you have faith, you have substance. And because you have faith, you have evidence. Faith so prepares for things yet unseen. You don't see it, but you know what? You have faith, and so you prepare for it. And so, in other words, you get the umbrella, although it hasn't began to rain. You get the umbrella. You may not even see clouds, but you get the umbrella. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 20 says, those who disobeyed God long ago, when God waited patiently while Noah was building his boat, only 8 people were saved from the drowning in that terrible flood. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5 says, and God did not spare the ancient world except for Noah and the 7 others in his family. Noah warned the world of God's righteous judgment, so God protected Noah when he destroyed the world of ungodly people with a vast flood. And so faith, it prepares for things yet unseen. And so when God warns us that things are going to happen, that something is going to happen, it's important that we listen to God. Sometimes a parent may warn a child, you know, don't touch that stove because that stove is hot. And some folk don't believe that the stove is hot. And so Noah, the Bible lets us know that by faith, he believed God. He believed God. He believed God. Guess what? Although it had never rained before, he began to prepare for what he had never seen. And he trusted that what God said God was going to do, that God would actually do it. And so Noah, he got to work when God told him, here's what's going to happen. And then he got to work and he began, when God told him, here's what you need to do and here's how you need to do it. Others, they didn't expect the warning to come to pass. And so, beloved, faith, it prepares for things unseen. Now, I'm not talking about chasing after conspiracy theories. But, beloved, we need to realize that there is a day of judgment that is coming, that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Hallelujah. And there are things that we are warned about. There are some things that God may speak in your spirit that may warn you about. Some writing, you can see it on the wall. Faith prepares for things yet unseen. Don't wait for the storm. Build the boat now. Don't wait for someone to break in your house. Get the alarm system down. Get the cameras now. Not only does faith prepare for things unseen, faith, secondly, it compels us to do what hasn't been done. Faith compels us to do what hasn't been done. I want to put this another way, because I don't want you to think that faith is necessarily fanatical. You know, that we feel that we need to always jump out and chase things that's never been done. That's not the point here. But faith does compel us to do what hasn't been done. Another way of thinking is that faith does differently. Faith does differently. In other words, as a person of faith, we grow and we are strengthened in our faith. We grow and we are strengthened in our faith. All things are made new. God makes us new. And so we grow and we develop. And God is constantly making us new, making us more and more like Jesus Christ. Faith compels us to do what hasn't been done. And so, in other words, we become different. We develop and we are transformed qualitatively. God makes us better. We exercise our faith. God, when we exercise our faith, we are stretched. God is stretching us. Faith stretches us, and we become different. Not only in regards to faith doing differently in the sense of making us different, faith also compels us to do different things. When you have faith, faith will compel you to do different things and to do things differently. Oh man, that's a word. That's a word from the Lord. Faith does differently. What do you mean? That faith makes us different, but then faith, it compels you and I to do different things and to do things differently. Because if you want the same results, keep on doing the same thing. But if you want some different results, you can't keep doing the same thing. You've got to do something different, or you have to do things differently. Why? Because faith does differently. Because when we allow God to change, to transform us such that we become different people, that we are being transformed, then we'll do things, we'll do different things, and we'll do things differently because they make a difference to the glory of God. They make a difference in our churches. They make a difference in our family. They make a difference in our world. Why? To showcase God's love for the world, to showcase God's great salvation to humankind, to extend salvation to all people. Faith compels us to do what hasn't been done. Listen, and it may not be that it's never been done, but it may simply be, watch this right here. And I remember when I was studying this, as I was studying this passage, it may not be that it's never been done. It may be that you've never did it. Okay, let me say that again. It may not be that it's never been done, but faith may compel you to do what you've never done. Yes, to stretch you, to cause us to move outside of our comfort zone, to do what we have not done. Faith, it does differently. Faith does differently. Obedience to God. Now watch this. Here's the thing. You may experience some backlash. Why? Because obedience to God, it can appear strange or foolish to other people. Obedience to God, it makes you different. Obedience to God, it condemns the status quo. When you look at the text, what we see is that by this act of obedience, that Noah, he condemned the world. He condemned the world. He condemned the world. He condemned the world. And so watch this right here. Let me put this in perspective. Jesus didn't come to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And although Jesus didn't come to condemn the world, folk were condemned because of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Because he came as light, and darkness can't dwell in light. And so it's not that in your living and acting in faith and you being different and you doing the things that God has called you to do, that is meant to condemn or be a judgment to others. But fact of the matter is that your righteousness, that you're acting in faith, that it condemns the status quo. Because faith does differently. It condemns the status quo. It condemns the status quo in regards to the world and even church culture. Because faith does differently. Obedience to God, it makes disobedience stand out, because sometimes God may be leading others to do a thing, but they are disobedient because folk want to do their own thing. Do what God tells you to. Some of you wondering, okay, some of you, maybe your struggle is this right here. Do what God tells you to do, and don't be overly concerned about God's part or someone else's part. I was in an event on yesterday, and it was such a blessing to celebrate those who are in the medical and health field, particularly here in Waterbury, and an individual stood up and indicated, you know, that there's a plan, that there is a strategy, and that he had done everything that God had put on his heart to do. And in regards to certain things such as provisions, there were some provisions, but not all provisions, but he's trusting God for the rest of the provisions. See, there are some things that we need to concern ourselves with, and that is the things that God has told us to do. And then we allow God to do the things that only God can do. Hallelujah. Whether that be God directly through a miracle or God through people, hallelujah, to make the vision come to pass. See, don't be overly concerned about God's part or someone else's part. Noah, he didn't have to gather the animals. God took care of those details. Handle what you can handle. Your assignment, your responsibility. Control what you can control. Your attitude, your words, your behavior. Faith. It prepares for things unseen. Faith compels us to do what hasn't been done, because faith, it does differently. Faith, it makes us different. Faith, it compels us to do different things and to do things differently. Faith, it will make a difference in the world. And then lastly, faith, watch this, it builds for the future. Faith builds for the future. Because here's what you see right here. Here's what you see when you look right there in the text, that Noah built a large boat. Noah built a large boat that had never been done before. That had never been done before. Noah built a large boat. It had never been done before. Noah was warned by the Lord, and it had never rained the way it rained. Rain had never come from the sky. There had never been a flood of this magnitude. But nonetheless, he obeyed. And the Bible says that he did it to save his family, to save his household, for the salvation of his family. And I need some of you to know that faith, it builds for the future. It may take a while, but faith, it builds for the future, because it's about paving the road for other people. Hallelujah. God's intent was always to save humankind. Yes. God saved Noah in order to save humankind. God raised up Abraham in order to raise up a people to save humankind. God sent Jesus in order to save humankind. Faith builds for the future, not just right now. And yes, we should have a now faith, but faith, it builds for the future. Faith builds for the future. Do you have faith for a different future? Do you have faith for a different future? But beloved, what that means is that you're going to have to do some different things. You're going to have to do some different things. What that means is that you're going to have to do things differently. You can't do the things that you've been doing the same way. And how is God stretching you right now? What is God speaking in your spirit? What is God speaking to your heart right now concerning faith? Concerning your life, concerning your family, concerning your marriage, concerning your ministry, concerning your job. What is God saying? Because it's not simply about you, but faith, it builds for the future. Do you have faith? Do you have faith for a different future? Beloved, let's exercise faith, divine faith, for a different future. Preparing for things yet unseen. Doing what hasn't been done, what you have not done. Building for the future. God's word for the people of God. Praise be to God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Ah, dear Lord, we love you and we give you thanks, oh God. We thank you for faith, Lord God. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing comes by the word of God. Lord God, we thank you for faith, Lord God. For faith, it is a gift, Lord God. And so we ask, Lord God, that you would increase our faith, that you would grow us in faith, Lord God. Thank you, God. Strengthen us in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Lord, help us to overcome doubt and fear, Lord God. Thank you, God. Lord, for we know that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, oh God. Lord, and so strengthen us in the name of Jesus. Lord God, not to worry about the journey, Lord God. Lord, but to take the steps, to do the things that you have showed us to do, that you've shown us to do, Lord God. To step in those steps, Lord God. Lord, to handle the assignment that you have given us, the task that you have given us, Lord God. Lord, that like Noah, that we might be obedient, Lord God. Lord, as you show us each step, that we will be obedient to do the things that you show us to do. Lord God, that we would not fret, that we would not worry, that we would not concern ourselves with naysayers, Lord God, with doubters, Lord God. Lord, with those who may think, Lord God, that the thing that you have directed us to do, Lord God, that it is foolish, Lord God, that it doesn't make sense, Lord God. Lord, we thank you. Lord, for as Noah, as he preached that message, Lord God, that it's going to rain. Lord God, as he worked on a boat, Lord God. Heavenly Father, we pray, Lord God, that we will continue to work, Lord God, to work on the project that you have put in our hearts, Lord God, the thing that you have spoken to our spirit, Lord God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Lord, we pray, strengthen our faith, deepen our faith, Lord God. May we be rooted in the faith, Lord God, for a different future. A different future, and it all to your glory, Lord God. Lord, we thank you for your great salvation. Lord God, because Jesus is coming back. Lord, you sent Jesus. He lived and he died, Lord God. Crucified upon Calvary's cross, buried, Lord God. On the third day, he got it with all power in his hand. Lord God, and he's coming back again, oh God. He's coming back again, Lord God. And so you call us as a people to be ready. You call the human race to be ready, Lord God. Hallelujah. By receiving your great salvation, responding to your love by grace through faith, Lord God, putting our trust in you, Lord God. Hallelujah. To save us, Lord God, to redeem us, Lord God, to make us right with you, Lord God, because that is only by faith. We are made right by faith with you, Lord God. We are made right by faith, Lord God. We're made right with you by faith. Lord God, so I pray for any of those that under the sound of my voice, Lord God, that desire your great salvation, Lord God. Lord, that want to be in a close relationship with you, Lord God, that repent of their sin, Lord God. Hallelujah. And seek forgiveness, Lord God, and to be in a loving, saving, life-giving relationship with you, Lord God. Lord, I pray that you would save them right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God, before it is ever too late. Lord, we thank you for your great salvation. Thank you, God. Thank you for faith for a different future. And God's people together said, amen. Amen. God bless you, beloved. Thank you so very much for joining with us. We look forward to seeing you next week.
Be blessed.
Thank you for joining us today. You can connect in the following ways. Our Sunday morning worship at 11 a.m. via Facebook at Mount Olive, Waterbury, Connecticut, or our YouTube channel at Mount Olive AME Zion Church, or our website, MountOliveAMEZ.org, or you can simply use the dial-in number 339-207-6251. If you desire to make a donation, simply go to our website, or you can download the Giveify app and search for Mount Olive AME Zion Church. Again, thank you for tuning in. Hope we connect again.